Glory to God. Go to the word of the Lord with me here for a little while this afternoon, 1 Peter. Just appreciate you being here and what God's going to do and He's doing. I truly do thank my Lord and my Savior. And I'll tell you, we are a body. We each have our functions, church, in this body. And I want you to know every one of you are important to this body. Every function that goes on. I know a lot of times maybe everybody doesn't get recognized, but we're not doing it to be recognized. We try to recognize as we can, but I just want to encourage all of you to just let God work in your life and just have a personal revival, and that'll carry on into this body, and we'll just see God do wonderful things. Amen? He's been good to us. He's blessed us, and keep the fires burning, and just watch God help us and keep us. I know He's going to do it. I want to go back this afternoon and talk some more in 1 Peter. We'll go to 1 Peter 1 and 7, then I'm going to pick up again and share some more things from this epistle. 1 Peter 1 and 7. At the trial of your faith being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Amen. Just say amen to God's word. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. When you take gold out of the hills, you have to do something to it. You got to purge it. You got to purify it. Because a lot of times where it comes from, it's mixed with other things. And you have to take that gold and you got to work with it. You don't typically just go grab it and go and you got what you got. You got to work with it. You got to refine it. You got to melt it down. You got to purify it from foreign materials. And I will tell you that when we first come to God, there's faith. There has to be a faith to be saved. It's there. The faith is there. But I will tell you, a lot of times there's a mixture in us that God's got to get out. He's got to put us in the fire to purify our faith and to draw us out so that you and I, that our faith can shine. And your faith is the most important thing about you. That's just what it is. And how you trust God and how you view Him is the most important thing about you. We're talking about the who it is that we have faith in, because that's what determines, that's what's on test. The one, how what we believe about God, how we believe in God, what we think about Him. The devil wants you to think wrongly about God. The enemy wants you to get a bad attitude towards your Creator. He wants you to think that God's against you instead of for you. He wants you to think that somehow because you're in the trial, God has stopped caring about you. God doesn't want to, it's not really true to who He says He is. But we know different than that. And our faith is this. When the devil tempts us to make us think that God has deserted us, we point the things in our life to show, no, He's still my Father, and He cares for me, and He will bring me through this. And we have to be able in our lives to demonstrate in these times of testing and trial that our opinion towards God will not change. Our opinion and our heart towards the Father will be the same. And we've got to see this God and who He is. Now, I shared with you this morning about God being our Father. Peter talks about that He has elected us, which means we trust Him as to be sovereign. He has called us, which means that we trust Him to complete in us and give us the tools to do what He has asked us to do. He will equip us. And God is such that He has birthed us, and therefore we trust the nature that He has placed in us. We trust the Spirit of God that lives and dwells. We trust what we got at salvation. We know what we got is real. That song they used to sing here more than, I know what I got because I felt it when I got it. There's one thing, folks, that many times it sometimes comes down to that. That maybe there are times that intellectually people challenge you. They give you a question that you cannot answer. They ask you something that you cannot defend. They attack one of your doctrines and you're not able to give a proper response to it. But you still go back to the thing. I know that He saved me. I know that He made me whole. I know that He put a seed in me and that God lives in me. I know when He took the guilt and the shame away. I know when He put a new nature and He broke the power of drugs and alcohol and sex and lust in my heart and that He made me a new creature. I may not be able to answer and give you a defense on that doctrine, sir, but I can tell you Jesus is still real and He's still my Father because He's birthed me into the kingdom. And those things, it's got to be in us. He's our judge, which means we trust Him as our corrector and our disciplinarian. I know that God is going to take care to make certain that you and I are pure and holy through and through. And there's another aspect. I want to deal with that fatherhood towards another angle that Peter talks about quite a bit down in verse 22 of chapter 1. And it's this idea that if God is Father, He is the Father of us all. God, as He said, He's no respecter of persons. We have one Father, and that is God. Your Father is my Father. And I speak of the one who has begotten us by the Word in the Spirit. I'm going to tell you there's only one God the Father. And that's the thing we see in Scripture. I can say He's my Father. That's all right. But even more so, I'm going to say He is our Father. So that the one that chastens you is the one that chastens me. The one that leads you is the one that leads me. The one that calls you is the one that called me. And He didn't call us out as just an individual to do my own thing. We got too much of this independent mindset going on today that people are trying to live their Christianity independent of the body of Christ. He called us and baptized us into the body of Christ. We're members in particular, and the Father is our Father, and He's over all of us, and we've got to understand that. So that I tell you that it plays into this business of brethren. I cannot separate my heart towards God and my heart towards the brethren. How I treat God, how I'm going to treat my brothers, how I treat my brothers reflects on my attitude upon God, and how my attitude towards God reflects upon my attitude towards my brothers. And somewhere you and I got to see that the enemy tries to work and destroy the brotherhood, but you and I got to work to overcome that and be faithful not only to God but to one another. This plays into this idea of God being our Father. Chapter 1 and verse 22. See ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren. See that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently. Whenever there is testing and trial in this time when the church is undergoing persecution and test and that nature coming against it, there would be a temptation to turn against your brothers. There would be a temptation to turn against your family and against your parents. But they had to remain faithful. And he says, you know, God's our Father, you and I are brothers, and what we must do is we must love one another with a pure heart fervently. This becomes a test of our faith. That you and I, I'm going to love you, not because sometimes I always feel like loving you. Or you're going to love me not because you always feel like loving me. Sometimes not because you're in 100% agreement with me and everything about me. Let it be those idiosyncrasies that you and I have. Sometimes those little personality differences that we have to deal with and work with and forbear with one another. But we have determined that we're all going to the same place. We serve the same God. We're saved by the same blood. We're filled by the same Spirit. We live by the same Word. And God can accomplish unity in us. We're birthed by the same Word of God, by the same gospel that transformed us. And we have been made a family in the body of Christ. You purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit. That's what brings. Jesus said, if you know the truth will make you free. You continue in my word, you're my disciples indeed. And you know the truth, and you shall, the truth will make you free. In John 17, he said, sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is true. And he talked about another place that he would wash us with the washing of water by the word of God is the truth, and that truth has a purifying effect upon our life when we bow to it. But he said, this purified your soul. It brought it to a sense of single devotedness. And therefore, he says, love one another with a pure heart fervently. Can we say that our heart towards one another is pure and that it's devoted? That I'm devoted to God, but I am also devoted to my brother. And I love you with an intense love. Love one another fervently. This is not just a passive thing. This is not just see you on Sunday morning concept. This is a love of passion. This is a love of feeling. This is a love of intensity. This is a love that that you are singly devoted towards doing good to your brother. That I have got one object towards you in mind. And that my object towards you is not to save my reputation. It's not to save my feeling. It's not to somehow defend my own self. That my object and goal towards you is to do what's best for you. It's to treat you as God has treated me. It is to act towards you so that it will produce in you the greatest good. So that my heart towards you is that you will become what God wants you to become. And that my heart towards you is singly devoted. And you are my brother. And we work together. And we live together. And we operate together. And we do this together. And we're one family. We've got one father. But that kind of love must be intense. How would you rate your love for the brothers? How intense would you say your love is for the people of God? Don't expect that we can ever reach out and love the world if we do not love our own. Not going to happen. We can't ever love one towards another. And I challenge you to think about that. Just how intense is my love? How far will I go? How much will I put up with? How much will I bear with? How much offenses can I cover? We were talking about, I mentioned it in our sermon this morning, but in our Sunday school class, we're dealing with some of these concepts as well. And then just sharing with them that there's sometimes that things just have to be covered. As I said to you, that if I offend Brother Andrew and I really hurt this young man, whatever, and he comes to me and tells me, I'm offended at this, you've done this to me, and it has really hurt my heart, then I can tell you, Brother, I'm sorry, I apologize. But that's not going to take away that hurt. I'm telling you what it is. It's not going to cover for my wrong. I must apologize, but it's not going to cover. Andrew's going to have to do something about that. It's not going to take away the temptation of the enemy. It's not going to keep the enemy from coming and trying to tempt you over that hurt. Just like when I ask God, God forgive me. God forgives me, but not simply because I ask it. He's going to have a basis. He's going to have something to cover that sin. That sin's going to have something that it can cover and atone for. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that takes care of that. But the Bible says that charity covers the multitude of sin. That's fervent charity. This Peter talks about it a little later. And it's the idea that there's got to be a covering. And my love, given to me by the Holy Ghost, set apart in my heart, is going to have to be sufficient to overcome that sin and to take it and bury that offense and put it behind us and say, it's all right. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to dwell on it anymore. I'm not going to let that thing consume my thinking. I'm going to put it behind me. It's done with. It's over with. And the love of God will cover it and bury it. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to take an aggressive, intense love. That will take something on your part to say, we'll purposely reach out to this brother that's offended. I'm going to reach, and that's what God did to us. God's love to us was not passive. God just didn't sit up in heaven and say, okay, now, God, what are you going to do about it? He died, and he reaches out to us. He sends people to preach us the gospel. He sends folks out there to care about us. I've seen this happen too many times. Which the window is an offense, even after there's been an apology, even after there's been things maybe done properly that need to be done to reconcile. If you are not aggressive in restoring that relationship, a distance and a space will come between you, and your letter and your relationship will not be what it used to be. A husband and a wife, if there's a rift that comes between you, they have now got to work harder, even though they've reconciled. The devil's going to try to bring suspicion. The devil's going to try to say, there they go again. Oh, they're not going to repent. They come back to do it again. You've got to aggressively reach out in your love to that brother and that sister and say, I want to prove to them that I mean they're good. We talk about Jesus Christ as a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And he is. But that's what we're supposed to be. Let's just face it. Most down, blood, stick, and wage water, they say. And it's natural. Nothing wrong with it. If we have a natural connection by blood, we ought to be devoted one to another. They're my children, they're my children. They're my seed, they're my blood. My wife is my flesh, my blood. My mother, my sister, my flesh, my blood. You should not. There's a relationship there that we have. And there's a devotion that comes. And a love is simply by nature. Now, I'm going to tell you something. You and I have been related by the Spirit of God and the blood of Jesus Christ. And there's a devotion to one another that must develop within us as we put our faith. What causes me to reach out and love? What causes me to reach out and to work beyond this offense? Faith is what it is. It's a trial of your faith. Do you believe that God wants you all to be one family? Do you believe that God wants you to work together as brothers? Do you believe that God is able to touch your brother and speak to him the same way that he speaks to you? That is an act of faith, my friend. And every time we're on trial, it's not so much a test of our patience. It becomes a test of our faith as to whether or not we are going to believe God to help us to heal the hearts and the relationship and to have the love of God to build as we need to build. He talks about as well in reference to that. Business of being brothers, he mentions in chapter 2 and verse 17. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. In this context, he talks about it in the context of us being submissive to earthly authorities. But he tells me it's particularly in this public eye. Christians are always in the public eye. But really, we need to let it know out in that world. They need to see us, not just reaching out to love our enemy, and not just loving our natural families, our children, and our wives, that we do, but they need to see in us that we are devoted to one another. We love the brotherhood. I mean, there's nothing greater than when a brother's down in a testimony and goes to a hospital and the church and the family of God comes in there and demonstrates a love and an activity. And you may say, well, I'm just going to do it, it's my duty. No, I'm telling you, that's a testimony to that world out there. As we honor God and as we honor the king, we love the brotherhood. We love the family of God, and we reveal to this world how much we love one another. You know, sometimes we have disagreements, we have difficulties. But I'm going to tell you something right now. The church's problems ought to stay within the church. Amen. It's like a lot of times you've got family issues. They don't need to be broadcast all over the world. They don't need to be put on Facebook. Your family needs to deal with that. Sometimes, you know, you just need to deal with that within your own home. You need to help ask for the church, but somewhere there's got to be a society within the church that our secrets stay with us. And we're not talking about covering sin in the sense of overlooking sin. We're not talking about that. But I'm telling you, yeah, we do have challenges. But we don't appeal to the world for help. We don't go to them for their psychology. We go to the Word of God and to the Father that's over all of us and let them know, hey, in this world, in this church, we love the brotherhood and that we're devoted to one another. And that, yes, there are things. Sometimes we got to just keep some secrets, but we'll settle this among ourselves. We'll judge our own selves. We'll do what he said in 1 Corinthians 6. We'll set the wise to judge. And we're not going to take our struggles to the world. We're not going to go to the world and appeal to them for their counsel. They got nothing to offer us. We got a father who oversees his family. We got an elder brother who is the head of all. And I'm telling you, he is sufficient to help us do what we need to do. But it comes down to this trial of our faith. When the church is under pressure, when the enemy wants to divide us, do we really believe that God is able to sustain us and to unite us? I believe that God wants us to love one another. And I can love you, and you can love me, because God makes it possible. I read that verse recorded in 2 chapter 4 and verse 8. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. And use hospitality one to another without grudging. Here again is that idea of a red hot fervent love that you've got to have towards one another. But this idea of fervent, it's a different word than the other. It's still some of the same concept. But in that chapter 1, it was the idea of having love one another with pure heart fervently. It was the idea of something that's intense, something that's passionate, something that's deep, that's rooted. It's not something that's shallow. It's not something that's feeling oriented. It's something that's rooted in the heart and in the will, so that it's a deep, intense love. And here the word fervent is the idea of that which is something that's without ceasing. It's stretched out. It goes on. You can't exhaust it. When you have a fervent love towards your brother, I'm telling you, we don't go back. If we have covered a sin, if we have forgiven a transgression, if it's buried beyond us or behind us or whatever, we don't bring it up 5 months from now. We don't recall that thing 6 weeks from now. It's done. It's over. It's point. It has no switch off point. You know, I know I've been thinking somewhat about that business of forgiving. Sometimes, you know, our heart's such that we do just have to forgive. And maybe sometimes you can't extend forgiveness to somebody because they don't want it. They don't want your forgiveness. They don't want your reconciliation. But I still gotta forgive. I can't let that thing harbor in my heart. You can't do it. It'll destroy you. If I don't forgive, God doesn't forgive me. See, God ties my relationship with him to my brothers. Jesus told Saul, you have persecuted the church, you've pricked against me. You persecuted me, Saul. And you must understand that God loves all of his sons. He loves all of his daughters. And oftentimes I'll ask the Lord, Lord, give me your heart towards this brother. The way you love them, help me to love them. Give me your heart towards that sinner. How you see them, help me to see them. Please, Lord, let me think like you think. I don't have it, God. I can't do this in myself. But you got it. Your love is perfect. Give me your love. If he does it, he'll do it again and again and again. Now, this idea of not just the Father, but the idea of Jesus Christ. He gives us some ideas and some concepts of the Lord. Our faith is not just in the Father, our faith is in the Son. Let's look at some things, please. Chapter 1, verse 18. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things of silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Here he speaks of Christ as the lamb. He's a lamb without blemish. He's a lamb without spot. And know that you and I, our faith in him is as the Lamb of God. We have not been redeemed with corruptible things. Our redemption is eternal. Our salvation is eternal. I know that we have looked at this business of eternal salvation, and the folks that have put a twist on that, that is warped. I understand that. They have made it that it's based not really on a living faith. It's not based on a continual faith. It's based on a one-time confession. Or it's based on a one-time act of water baptism, and thereby, no matter what they do after that, I know that's a perversion. But I want you to understand on the flip side of this. I need to know that my salvation is eternal. I need to know that my salvation is based on more than simply just what I can do about it. I need to know that when God saved me and forgave me, it was based on something permanent. It wasn't based on something temporary. It wasn't even based just on my confession. But it's rooted in the blood of Jesus Christ. And you and I have got to know that our redemption, Jesus, is our lamb, and it's our faith in him. He has redeemed us. He has purchased us. And when we're questioned, and when the enemy attacks and brings it to you, do you really know you're saved? Or maybe you're not saved. Maybe it's not right. Maybe it's not going to last. You're never going to make it as a Christian. But I'm going to tell you this. My salvation is based in the eternal blood of Jesus Christ, who lived for me and died for me and gave us and redeemed me. His blood paid the price for my sin. Sometimes people do have a hard time forgiving themselves. Sometimes you can be harder on yourself than other people will be. When you fail, when you mess up, you're not careful. You can't beat yourself to death over it. There does arrive a place that you just got to say, you know what? No, devil, I'm not worthy. Yes, I failed. But the blood has covered it. I repent. I turn to God. And the blood has taken care of the stain. And I don't know what you want to do, but I'm moving on. Glory to God. It's done with it. I know of a brother that fell into a particular sin and had a struggle and a conflict. And for a time, it was so difficult to overcome. And he went to Christ and he overcame it. But in that sense, it was time after time. People kept wanting to badger. And people kept wanting to know what really happened and this and know this detail. And finally, you know, he did. He answered. He answered questions for folks up front. But there came a time that after he'd gone by for some time, someone called up and asked and he said, too late. It's too late. It's come too late. It's done. It's buried. It's over with. I'm not digging any more of it out. I'm not saying any more. It's already been done. It's been confessed. It's been told. It's been done. You should have come a year ago. You're way too late. I'm not doing it anymore. You see, sometimes we keep digging it up. We keep going over that thing. And then there comes a time you just gotta bury it, my friend. It's done with. It's over. But I never got my satisfaction. I'm not worried about your satisfaction. I want to know if the Lord is satisfied. Is the Father satisfied? He's redeemed me by the blood of the Lamb. And my faith is in that blood. I trust that my sins are gone. I trust what I'm a sea of forgetfulness. I've been delivered from it. And it's time to just move on in Jesus Christ. Sometimes folks want to keep digging at it. Quit digging. Just move on. Somewhere, you said you've been redeemed for your vain conversation. Received by tradition from your fathers. I'm going to tell you this, whether speaking to Jews or Gentiles, they learned their idolatrous practices from their fathers. They got their Jewish traditions from their fathers. And I'm telling you, what Jesus gave us was brand new. A young man we spoke to yesterday, a universalist, a Unitarian, but he got a lot of those roots and seeds. Vain conversation. Maybe it's a worthless lifestyle. That's what it is. Vain is empty, profitless, worthless. Conversation refers to how you live your life. Basically, that worthless life that you were living, you got it from your family. You were trained in it by your mom and your dad. And it just came down. You got it from that which was handed to you, where you learned it from. But understand this, turn away. You've been redeemed from that. God brought you out of that vanity and that utter uselessness and brought you in a place of profit and usefulness. And now, he has restored you to your original position. And where God wants you to live, live in it, praise the Lord. If the pardon is ours, it's ours. If healing is ours, it's ours. If the power of the Lord is ours, then it's ours, glory to God. God doesn't give it to you with strings attached to it. He wants you to obey him and love it. And I'm telling you, he reaches out and pours into you. And all that he died for at Calvary, he wants to pour it out in your life. If he didn't spare his own son, he didn't do it so he could freely give us all things. He's not stingy. He's a generous God. And that's who we have placed our faith in. Secondly, he makes a statement of Jesus in chapter 2. That he's a living stone, verse 4. To whom coming us into a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. And you're living stones, he said. You're built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Now he tells us not only is our faith in him as a lamb, but as a living stone. We're not just accepting his pardon and the resources and provisions of his redemption, but his will beyond that, that you and I have built our lives upon him. He has become the pattern for us. He is the living stone. He's the headstone of the corner. He's the cornerstone. Let's just put it this way. Our lives are staked on Jesus Christ. If Jesus fails, we fail. If Jesus falls, we fall. If the church goes under, we go under. But we believe it's a living stone. It's not just a headstone. It's a living stone. It means that Jesus is rock solid. You can build your life on him, and the storms of life will not destroy you. You've got to know somewhere. I tell you what, it's easy to get overwhelmed. You know, you can speak about things. You got your children. You know they're saved. What's going to happen when I'm not? We know we're here. We're preaching now. We got elders. Are these young men going to carry it? We're gone. What's going to happen in the next generation? What kind of challenges are we going to face? Are they going to be able to endure that? This thing is not dependent on one generation. It's dependent on the family of Jesus Christ. He is the cornerstone, and we are built on him. We're a holy priesthood, and we are a spiritual house. The world may not see the house, but we see the house, and we are built up, connected to one another, a house, a place where God lives and dwells in us. Sacrifices are being carried to God. We offer them up, and the idea of offer up is to carry something. It's to bear it. We bear the needs. We bear the sacrifice. use it. It just made such an impression on me yesterday in our conversation. With a young man, it'll, questions will be asked that'll make you think. And God gave grace and mercy. But I'm telling you, this thing still comes back to a simple, I'm living by faith. I said, I can't prove to you creation, and you can't prove to me evolution. Both have to be accepted by faith. I would never God made the world. I wasn't there when he created Adam and Eve. Neither were you. Nobody's lived billions of years to tell you it's evolution. The only way you can prove it is if somebody truly lived a billion years and could say, I witnessed the changes. Here's the evidence without witness. But we do have a witness, glory to God. And his name is Jesus Christ. We're not without a witness. He was there when Adam was born. He was there when Eve was made from the rib of Adam. He was there when God said, let there be light, and there was light. He was there when God said, let the earth bring forth, and the beast of the field came, and he said, let the waters produce, and the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea. I can tell you that he was there. It was him who had declared, I cannot read. And from the beginning it was not so. But God made them male and female. I'm telling you, he was in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by him and for him. And without him, nothing was made in his way. How would you understand that Jesus Christ was a witness to the creation of man, and by building our life on a solid cornerstone? Now, let's just face it. The builders. Who are the builders? Have you ever thought about who the builders are in our culture? Well, you'll have to go to the intellectuals in our universities. You'll have to go to our civil leaders. What minds are influencing them? You'll have to go to our media, moguls or whatever, those who are operating and controlling that. Let's just face it. What are the major influences that are shaping this culture? And I will tell you, there's not as many people involved in that as you think there are. That is just the general No, I'm telling you, the general population is affected by the minds of a few. The minds of our youth are being brainwashed by the intellectual professors or the intellectuals of our day and the professors of our day. It's those that have gained the influence in the society, those who have control of the media. I'm not talking about some conspiracy theory. I'm just telling you, every nation's got builders. We had some great God. We had some men in this nation. In the beginning, we had so many 50-some signs of the Declaration of Independence. We called them our framers. We called them the builders of this nation. But they built it on Jesus Christ. They built it on the Word of God. They respected the truths that were in this book. But the builders today have rejected the cornerstone. They've rejected the builders in Jesus' day.
And restore them and put it
so that it'll ease that gas of the devil now and keep them from dying. But I'm going to tell you something. This is sometimes you need your soul restored. So that word restore meant to take something back to its starting point. Take something back to its place of origination. The psalmist David crying and thinking for a song will restore to me the joy of my salvation. Hallelujah. But sometimes you do get down. But sometimes you do get overwhelmed. But sometimes, if you're not careful, you can get dry. And you need a refreshing. You need God to put the joy in your life that used to. Glory to God. But I'm telling you, don't look elsewhere. Go to the shepherd. Oh, sometimes we're looking to someplace else for a restoration of our joy. We're looking to a pleasure. We're looking to some source of entertainment. No, I tell you, an old-fashioned altar will restore your joy like nothing else will. Just get him down and say, Holy Shepherd, will you restore my soul? The days of faith, the test of our faith, will we trust him to guide us through this life? Amen. You know, walk through the valley of shadow of death, or fear no evil. Maybe it has its application. But why is it that we always think that refers to when we've lost a loved one? When he talks about the sheep, and David is personifying the sheep, putting himself in the place of the sheep, and he talks about walking the valley of shadow of death, he's talking about losing his mama sheep. Now, I'm not saying God didn't comfort you in death. We need that. He does comfort us in the death of our loved ones. But I don't think that's really what he's getting at here. The idea is that shepherd is leading that flock of sheep, and he takes them through the valley. And in the signs, as they walk through the valley, there are big rocks and things alongside the path. And behind those hide foxes. Behind those will hide wolves. Behind those will hide the coyotes and the bears that can come out from them. It's a valley of the shadow of death. It's walking through a place where the enemy is walking on every side, watching for an opportunity to destroy you. I'm telling you, about a lot of this life is a valley of the shadow of death. Every day, sometimes we walk through in our forces and are working against the church. We come to a place in a nation, a man can't even sell a cake. Who he wants to sell a cake to? And we got a force to make a wedding cake for a lesbian couple. I'm thinking, what have we done? How far have we come? When a man is not free to sell his products, and who he wants to sell his products? And we got a force to go against his conscience. No way! I'm telling you, the forces are against us. The devil's working on every side, but that's all right. He's wrong, and his staff comes with the wolf cut out from the side, and the rod in the hand of the Lord will cut across the head of that wolf and take him out. The Lord will preserve me in the midst of the wickedness in which we dwell. I'm telling you, the Bible's got to get beyond rhetoric for us. We gotta just quote that when we're out there. You can feel the enemy clutching. You can feel the destructive forces. Then say it. Don't wait till it's a few. Then say it. Then do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That is lurking. Death is lurking in the shadows. Death is hiding behind every rock and crevice. That's all right. I look up there at the shepherd. He's not afraid. He's got an old staff in his hand. He's got a rod. It was so long. And they were accurate. Those shepherds could throw that rod with deadly accuracy and let that wolf come. And he could throw that rod and connect to the head of that wolf and take him out. He wasn't afraid. And that don't work to take up a stand. And that don't work. It can be like David. He said, I took my bare hands. And I grabbed that lion by his mane and I smote him.
You'll have to. It's not pride. It's called faith.
trust that in this day of ungodliness and immorality, the Spirit will sanctify me and bring me to full obedience. That he will impress upon me the holiness of God. That's why we're filled. It's this idea that we're baptized in the Holy Ghost. He doesn't talk about us being baptized into the Spirit of God. Although it's the same person. But the emphasis is you're baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because the emphasis is that baptism is going to make an impression of holiness upon you. And that's what needs to be restored to Pentecost. Pentecost means a restoration of holiness again. It needs an imprint. We're not just baptized in the Spirit. We're not just baptized in some influence. We're baptized in the God that is holy, 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 holy. And somewhere, the baptism of the Holy Ghost is going to make an impression of holiness upon your heart. It brings a hatred of sin and a love for righteousness. It brings a hatred for immorality and a passion to live holy and righteous in the sight of God Almighty. I'm not telling you anything new, but I'm trying to tell you, we don't have an excuse. We don't want an excuse. If we fail, we're going to cry out, we're going to go back and make it right. And we're going to reach up and ask for more power. Because we must overcome. We must overcome. Chapter 4, and I close with this verse in verse 14. To be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. He talked about it was the Spirit that sanctifies us. Now he talks about in our reproach. That word reproach means you're chided, you're upbraided, you're railed upon, mocked, ridiculed for the name of Christ. I don't know of anything other than Christianity that can make you happy whenever everybody else is fussing at you. I don't know of any religion on the earth that can give you that. But why are we happy? Because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon us. I hear that word rest, I think about the Lord at his baptism. John said, it was said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining, he it is that baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And the dove came, and the Spirit of God rested upon him. And there it was, peace and tranquility, and the power of God resting upon him. And he went out into that world to preach the gospel unto the poor, and to be mocked, and to be ridiculed, and to be rejected of men. It may be that now that you and I are reproached in this world, but when that takes place, the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon us. And this word resteth, it does this sense of rest, but it comes out, and that which comes out of refreshing. It's the idea of refreshing in order to give rest, to cause someone to cease from their turmoil because you've been able to refresh them. And I will tell you right now, there's nothing better that you and I need when we've been under the gun, when we've been reproached, and we come together and we have a Holy Ghost anointing power pack service, when we shout and dance and praise God, and run the aisles, and the Holy Ghost just fills us up, and the glory of God rests upon us. We may have been rejected of men, but the glory of God will rest upon us. He has seen us, but God will glorify us. And when the refreshing of the Spirit comes, we'll go right back out to that world, and we'll preach the gospel again to them, and tell them again about Jesus Christ. That's what you and I got to have. And we got to trust in this day that the Spirit of God will refresh us in this hour. I don't know about you. Sometimes, how quickly we can get down. How quickly we can get discouraged. Well, what the words he had to preach the fiery sermon for 5 services now. Something must be wrong somewhere. Well, nothing wrong. I said, hey, man, time to pray for a refreshing on this place. Yeah, that's not me. Can't let that go on, God forbid. But at the same time, let's not think I was lost. Let's not think, hey, we haven't had a sound service for 3 weeks. Okay. Then let's pray in that one.
Let's have some faith and let's have some hope. Let's have some faith in this day and hour and say, let it not be a little tough now. It'll help us after a while. It might be a little tough now.
We're not trusting one another. We're not trusting ourselves. We're trusting God. Would you just raise your hand and say, oh, I'm a faith. I got to see it. I got to see that you're doing these things. Help me. And my faith will stay true to you in the house which we live in. Father God in heaven. Let me love.